This is FemmeSciComm's 10th vlog, and to continue our posts on pregnancy, today's post is on PCOS and pregnancy. PCOS, if you haven't heard, it stands for polycystic ovary syndrome and affects 5 to 15% of women in reproductive age. It's a very common endocrine or hormonal disorder. So this paper was recently published in Endocrinology. Maternal high-fat diet consumption and chronic hyperandrogenemia are associated with placental dysfunction in female rhesus macaques. The first author is Kelly Kuo, and the senior author is Antonio Frias, both from Oregon Health and Science University. So this study tries to answer, what effects do excess testosterone and a high-fat diet have on pregnancy? First, why look at testosterone and diet? Well, these are major factors that comprise the characteristics of PCOS. PCOS is most simply defined as the presence of hyperandrogenism and/or chronic anovulation. Testosterone is a type of androgen. PCOS also has major metabolic consequences related to insulin resistance, which can lead to weight gain. There have been several studies in the last couple decades on PCOS and pregnancy outcomes, but there have been conflicting literature regarding the association between PCOS and adverse pregnancy outcomes, possibly due to other factors such as androgen levels, varying degrees of body fat percentage, and insulin action. So that's why the researchers want to test the effect of testosterone and diet separately. The researchers' hypothesis for this study is that excess testosterone, hyperandrogenism, and a high-fat diet during pregnancy can lead to placental dysfunction. On to their data. After following the rhesus macaques for about 3.5 years, the researchers recorded their baseline characteristics. They found that a high-fat diet led to a statistically significant gain in body fat percentage, as well as a more acidic umbilical artery pH after giving birth. What the acidic umbilical artery pH means is that the fetus is possibly undergoing hypoxic or low oxygen stress. The only statistically significant change due to the treatment of testosterone is an increase in serum testosterone, which makes sense. Regarding placental blood flow, a maternal high-fat diet led to an increase in mean flux rate and decrease in video intensity. The increase in mean flux rate of placental blood flow suggests shear stress-induced vascular injury, and the decrease in video intensity implies impaired circulation. Other differences in the placenta resulting from diet included an increase in villus volume fraction, decrease in intervillous space, and a change in villus capillary volume fraction. Changes in placental stereology due to testosterone comprised of just an increase in villus volume fraction and a decrease in intervillous space. The authors say that this may be indicative of impaired angiogenesis, or the creation of blood vessels, at the subvillus level. Changes in placental architecture via placental growth and blood vessel markers were observed. Testosterone treatment was associated with increased protein expression of mTOR and SOX3. Finally, the researchers looked at any changes in placental glucose transporters in the GLUT family. GLUT1 and GLUT9 were dysregulated due to the high-fat diet. So, enough with their data, what does this all mean? Because there's conflicting literature regarding PCOS and adverse pregnancy outcomes, the research group decided to set up an experimental design to test testosterone and a high-fat diet on pregnancy separately. PCOS can be characterized by hyperandrogenism, which means high levels of androgen, and testosterone is a type of androgen, and metabolic defects, which can lead to obesity. Based on their data, the researchers saw that a high-fat diet leads to more changes in baseline characteristics and placental parameters. The data from this paper suggests that excess testosterone and a high-fat diet can lead to changes in the placenta, which may then lead to adverse pregnancy outcomes. However, no adverse pregnancy outcomes were noted in this study, and researchers recorded common parameters that are looked at in the hospital to determine if there will be a high-risk pregnancy. There are caveats and other factors to keep in mind. First, they have a small pregnant sample size. Only 22 out of the original 39 macaques become pregnant, so only 4 to 6 per group. The next factor to keep in mind is that this study was done on rhesus macaques, and there are differences between the human model and rhesus macaque model. Next, there are differences between excess testosterone and hyperandrogenism. Androgen is different from testosterone. Testosterone is a type of androgen. Next, researchers only began a high-fat diet about 3 years before pregnancy. A previous research study looked at rhesus macaques for about 5 years after beginning their diet. 3 years may be too soon to see any changes. Finally, there were no differences in infant weight and head circumference, and I mentioned already that there were no noted adverse pregnancy outcomes due to the testosterone treatment and high-fat diet. Overall, this study distinguishes the roles of testosterone and diet separately on pregnancy. Neither treatment led to adverse pregnancy outcomes, but there were some changes in placental architecture and blood flow. Thank you for reading, listening, and watching my assessment on this paper on pregnancy and PCOS. Keep informed, stay interested, and keep doing great women's health research. Bye! Thank you for watching. If you're interested in this content, please make sure to subscribe to my channel and like or share my post. I post every Thursday on FemmeSciComm.com on current research papers pertaining to women's health and reproductive medicine. You can also follow me on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and Pinterest at FemmeSciComm.